Welcome, 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 everybody. Can you believe right off the bat this morning we have this beautiful male lion? But just before we have another look at him, my name is Taylor and welcome. You're on a live African safari. We've got Eggsy or Xander, as some of you may know him. And it is so happy that we don't have a little bit of rain because it's warmed up quite nicely today. But have a look, another look at this beautiful big boy, just in case he gets up and moves around again. Now, everybody, can you believe that this is all happening right now? This is being filmed live as we speak, which is quite amazing. So if you'd like to interact with myself or Jamie, who's going to say hello to you a little bit later, you are welcome to either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can even email us. And you can email us on questions@wildearth.tv. Sorry, I just heard what sounded like some growling in the distance, or it could be a cruiser too, I'm not sure. Hang on, I'm just trying to have a quick listen. No, it's a vehicle. So this big male lion has been calling most of the morning, and I don't know if it's because he's declaring his territory or if he's actually looking for the rest of the female Nkuhumas who have been around too. Jamie thought she heard some calling coming a little bit further north of us, so possibly these lions that were sort of all spread out at the moment. Sorry, everybody, I have a little tickle in my throat. There we go, now he's up again. He's going to be doing this. He was also contact calling a little bit earlier. No, you're going to just face away from us, that's kind. And he has got a really big belly. Come on, do a big call. No. It sounded like he maybe wanted to start roaring. Let me reposition. Isn't this amazing? What an incredible start. I must tell you, everybody, we also had audio of a big male leopard this morning who I was actually trying to follow up on. And then I bumped into our friend over here, as you can see. And you can also see that the clouds are starting to lift. The air is warming up. And I think the rain could possibly be over until our next spell again. But we did have a really good amount of rain, and that's going to put lots of grass. Remember, everyone, we also got to do our picture a little bit later today on quarantine and compare the differences over the next few days as we watch the grass grow. But this is a really stunning looking lion. I was so shocked. I had to ask Jamie this morning and confirm with her, as well as the lovely ladies in final control this morning, if this was actually a Birmingham, because the two Birminghams that I've seen are very scarred up and are not the prettiest looking lions. But he, you know, I suppose in a family you've always got that one good looker. And this is him. What a lovely lion. There we go. Come on, come on, just let one roar out for us, everybody. If he could do a big roar, like what I've been hearing most of the morning, that would be amazing. And we are sitting no more than 10 meters away from this male lion, so I'm going to apologize now if he does start to roar, because I'm not going to say anything. The camera's probably going to vibrate a little bit because we're so close. And that will just give you an idea as well of the how powerful their voice actually is. Come on, boy, one more. So I wonder what he ate. I wonder if he maybe fed on that buffalo carcass, or what he's been doing. Maybe he caught something for himself. I don't know when they last saw this male or where they last saw him. So maybe some of you are very active and are watching all the dam cameras and watching all the Facebook pages of the different lions could help me out a little bit and let me know where this male was last seen. There we go, the rangers are starting to wake up. Good morning, Juan Madura and Gonyam. We are just on the western side of quarantine, that most western Dlela, and then slightly south from there. Just myself on lock. Just letting everybody know that we've got this beautiful big male lion. We can't keep a sighting like this a secret, everybody. I'm really hoping that he's going to roar so I can tell you a little bit more about the roar. I almost want to wait for him to do it. But now it doesn't seem like he's going to, so I'll tell you anyway. So a male lion's roar can reach about 130 decibels. That's like standing in front of those massive speakers when you go to a big rock concert and your body basically vibrates. You don't just hear it, you feel it. So they've got a resonating chamber. Come on, I'm talking about you roaring. You can, there we go, listen, listen. Oh, well, that was a little bit of a pathetic attempt, I'm afraid. He wanted to, and then he stopped. Even just those beginning stages of that roar, I could really feel the vehicle vibrating. So, sorry, as I was saying. No, no, come on. Oh, big yawn. Sorry, everybody. I keep stopping halfway through because I'm hoping that he is going to let out a big roar for us. Come on, come on. Come on. Do a big one. You did such a big, beautiful roar earlier this morning. Come on, boy. Maybe whoever can speak to the animals can ask him very nicely to let out a full roar this morning. But he's building up to something. So let's follow him. We just need to reposition now. And hopefully we get to experience this amazing roar. And then I'll be able to finish telling you about the roar. But for now, I'm just going to carry on with him just in case he does let out a bellowing howl. There we go, you see him actually marking his territory now. There you go. He's in a urine spray up against that tree. He also rubbed his cheek on those leaves, so they've got glands on the sides of their faces. And then the most common way that lions will mark territories is by spraying urine, as you can see at the moment. So if I wasn't sure if this was a Birmingham, I think this would be, there we go, listen. Morning. I hope you all cranked up the volume for that, and maybe your computer screens began to vibrate as well. I'm going to reposition. We're not going anywhere. We're staying with this boy. So as I was saying, I'm just going to quickly recap, seeing as now we've now heard this male roar. It's about 130 decibels that you experience. So the vibrations start in your toes and they wriggle all the way up through your body. I've got goosebumps after something like that. It's amazing to see something along those lines. Here you go, he's on the move again. And I was saying they've got that resonating chamber in the backs of their throats, which helps amplify the sound so that it bellows out like that. Here we go, we've got a male lion responding in the distance. So I presume now he's looking straight south, you can see that. And I can hear some lions down in the distance, the area that he is staring in. I think we're going to be battling some very thick vegetation this morning, because I'm sure he's going to make his way straight there. Maybe it was even a female that I heard. That's sort of where those females were left. No, he's going to sit down. Come on, somebody answered your call, and now you're just going to sit down. Right, everybody, I'm going to hang around with this Birmingham boy for a little bit longer. Let's go say good morning to Jamie.
Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Dave on camera. And what a beautiful morning it is promising to be. Fresh, cool and clear, lion roaring, leopard sawing. Now, whilst Taylor went off in search of a leopard, of course, Taylor, the lion whisperer McCurdy, found a lion. And she is over, actually we can see her, hold on, I'll show you where she is. With that lion, just over there. So our morning started off with Tingana, well I think it was Tingana, making a large racket, sawing right outside the DRC. Then the lion started roaring and I think Tingana decided that he was going to stay silent for a little while and not draw attention to himself. But he's here somewhere. And we're checking, while Taylor's been looking at this lion, we've been checking for this leopard to figure out where he's gone. I know Rickson was desperate to find him. He raced out first thing this morning. So he's out as well, helping us look. Let's see if we can't catch up with a gentleman who has been relatively elusive over the last few months. And Tingana is the dominant male leopard of this area. He's a massive male and he's wonderful. He's so terribly comfortable with vehicles and he's got that. And we spoke about this in the way that leopards are and what we love about leopards. And he's cool. Tingana is cool. He's just too cool. I'm hoping we're going to catch up with him now. The problem is with this wet soil, not that I'm complaining, is that leopards don't leave tracks. If I walked along this road now, I wouldn't leave a footprint. So it does get difficult. Our first few days after rain makes tracking tricky, but we're going to figure it out. We're going to figure this one out. Come on, Tingana. I'm hoping at some point he's going to saw and give away his position. When I talk about sawing for new viewers, and by the way, thank you to those of you who did send through the update that you could hear him on the dam camera. Obviously, we could hear him as well from TRC. Leopard sawing is their roar. It's the equivalent of a lion's roar, but a leopard's, and it sounds like somebody with a bow saw sawing a log or something similar. It's a sort of a sound. Oh, well, that was quite good. Not bad. They obviously do it much louder than I do. Standing by. Sorry guys, always try to call me. Copy, thanks Orbs. I'm just coming up to Zoe's now. That was going to be my next route. I'll also check with one of our tech guys who went in that direction. Right, now Connor's raced off to the Gowrie mast to go and change batteries, as always happens when it's a cloudy day. And the leopard's calling right there. So, between all of us, Rex is coming from the south. Aubrey's coming from the, what direction is that? East. And we are going from the north. And Tingana is on the move. Let's hope we can catch him before he gets to our boundary. He's definitely mobile west. Before I started chatting to Aubrey, Lou said, I wonder how ornithologists would write down the leopard call. And that's, of course, reference to the game we've been playing where we do literal readings of bird calls as written by ornithologists and bird watchers. Thoroughly entertaining. I think they'd probably just describe it as a sawing sound. Okay, we're going to race a little bit. I have a horrible feeling he's gone into his favourite block, which is just to the west of me. So while we search, let's go back to Taylor and her lion.
Well, Jamie, I wish you luck on your adventure trying to find Tingana. I've heard lots of wonderful stories about him, so really good luck there, and I hope you give it a good bash. We're still with my
righty. Unfortunately, Taylor's disappeared off your screens. And we will get that sorted out very, very soon. As I said, the Gowrie repeater runs off solar power and it's, well, the batteries are charged by solar power and we haven't had any solar over the last 2 days. Again, not that we're complaining because it's brought some much needed rain. And I have to say, while we look for this leopard. It is a really, really beautiful morning. The sun is threatening to pop through the clouds. It's damp, it smells like wet earth, petrichor, for those of you who enjoy that particular word. I know it's one of James's favorites. The smell of the earth after rain. And I promise you, for us, it is a most welcome smell indeed. Remember how we said yesterday, if you were watching our safaris, that it's a wonderful time just after the rain because all of our big cats and territorial animals are out and about remarking their territory. And that's exactly what Tingana is doing now. So he knows, as the dominant male leopard, instinctively he knows that his scent mark will have been washed away by the rain, and he will have no desire for another male to take a chance and think that the territory is unoccupied. So he heads out and he remarks his territory. My instinct tells me to look for tracks, but at the same time I know I'm not going to see them. Plus Connor's come through this way. We best warn Connor that he might have a nice leopard sighting. I'm sure he would enjoy that. Where should we go? Now what do we think, everybody? Once we get to the Balanites Junction, if the leopard is not there, should we go in Parlor Plains or shall we go south? Which way is Tingana going to go? He usually goes straight west. But that's usually, and this is Tingana, who's a leopard. And there is no real usually when it comes to leopards. Ah, no! Connor heard him, and apparently it was already west of where Connor is. Connor's at Gowrie Mast. There's Rexon! I'll give him that update now, quickly. Oh my goodness, there's Connor. Oh no, it's Connor's worst nightmare. He's coming around the corner and we're live. Sorry, Connor. Rex. Shame. I'm sure we can save him the embarrassment and let him go past. Calling that side. Perfect, thank you. West of it. Perfect, thank you very much. Cheers, Connor. We won't tell him we were lying. Rex. Let's head back to Taylor, she's got signal. I'll catch up with you soon.
Oh, we're just getting, unfortunately, the end of this lion's roar again. He is very vocal this morning and he's now going to walk us through some very thick vegetation, I think. So let's just try and keep ahead of him. It's only me here, which is going to prove interesting. Sometimes it's nice to have an extra vehicle to help out, just so that they can sort of play leapfrog. But hopefully, he's going to come towards the road. Please come towards the road. Okay, we need to try and find another way in here. Let's go here. So he's now going to the toilet. That's fine. It'll buy us some time this morning. There we go, there he is. Look how he's just gazing off into the distance. So I don't know if he's maybe been hearing this leopard that Jamie has been chatting about. I've got my earpiece in, so it's proving, hang on. No, I can hear leopards. I mean, I can hear the other lions calling in the distance, everybody. I think they're in the same spot as they were last night. Good morning, Debbie from Vancouver. Debbie wants to know if this lion would feel uncomfortable while he's roaring with all that food inside his belly? And the answer to that is no, otherwise he wouldn't be roaring so frequently. So most of the time, yes, he's pushing the sound out from his stomach, but like I said, Debbie, there's actually a resonating chamber in the back of their throat, and that is what's producing that echoing sound. So it doesn't really have too much to do with their bellies. And like I said, now I can hear the others calling in the distance, so maybe it's the females though, because it's not quite a big roar. It's sort of quite subtle, and it's not a complete roar like what we've been hearing with this male either. So possibly those other lions are in the same spot as where Jamie left them last night. And it'll be quite nice to see if some more of the Birminghams will join up together. I think there's nothing more powerful than seeing more than one male lion together. And for those of you who have never watched the show, this is the Birmingham male, and he's got some, I suppose you could call them brothers. They might not all be blood brothers, they could be from different females, but they have four of them now in their coalition. Unfortunately, there were five, and one succumbed to a buffalo injury, and now I am slowly being introduced to the entire group that moves around in this northern section of the Sabi Sands. But look at him there, look at the gaze that he does. One of my favorite photos is actually to just frame his face and get a proper close-up. I think there's nothing more beautiful, nothing more powerful than that. Look at that. You'll see if any of the photos I ever take, I always take one, and I've got such a beautiful one of him this morning, and he's gazing straight towards us. It almost looks like he's looking straight. No, he's not, but earlier it looked like he was looking straight through me. Come on, I think you need to get up and go towards that other group of lions. Good morning, Patricia. Patricia wants to know if this male lion, Blondie, is calling to the other Birminghams or if he's calling to the Nkuhuma pride. Now, Patricia, from what I can hear, or whoever is responding, it actually sounds like it could be some of the females that are responding. But I think he's just trying to find whoever he can. Remember, these males, because they are sort of roaming and dominating this area, they want to come past and see all the females every now and then, just to make sure that if there is anybody coming into estrus, they're going to be the ones that are mating with them. Come on, make your next move. You can see he's got a really lovely mane, and you can see how it's darkening at the tips as well. So he's slowly coming into the prime of his life. They're going to be really beautiful if they do get a little bit dark. He's almost got one dark streak on the top of his head as well. And that's normally a sign of really good genetics, is if they have a completely black mane. Beautiful boy. I can see why they call him Blondie, though. That's sort of what my hair looks like when there's a lot of humidity. It frizzes up like that. You can hear all the other birds waking up this morning too. When he calls, everything sort of goes quiet in the bush. It's quite an experience, actually. And now the birds have obviously realized that they can have an opportunity to voice their opinions of the morning. It's all happening on Duma this morning. We're very lucky. Yes, one more for us. One more big roar. He wants to. He's sort of quite predictable now. He is building up to those massive roars. Does a few little soft contact calls, and then he lets out a massive howl, I suppose. It's pretty amazing to be able to be sitting here and experiencing all of this. It's sort of, it almost feels like it's unreal. Now you're going to have a nap. It's exhausting. I don't know where he's come from, everybody. I'm still waiting for somebody to let me know where this male was last seen. So we can sort of gauge and see how far he's actually walked. Because if he has been roaming around the entire night, he may possibly just stay here and have a little siesta. He looks exhausted. Look how his eyes are closing now. One more roar. Now he's looking the other way. That's also a beautiful opportunity for a screen capture, everybody. See how every now and then he'll sort of lift his head. There we go, exactly like that. Tilt his nose up towards the wind. He's trying to pick up on their scent as well. He is sitting downwind of whoever is responding to his calls. Maybe he's saying, hey, you guys come towards me. I'm not walking all that way. It's thick bush and I just had my hair done. I don't want to get snagged on any of these thorns. I don't know. I don't know if he'd be saying that. He looks like a pretty boy. There we go. Now he's looking straight at us, everybody. You should be feeling that glare on your screens at home. Remember, we are live, and if you'd like to chat to us or send in any questions or any comments, you can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv, and I so look forward to hearing from all of you this morning. And now it's getting cold again. It was bizarre that it was so warm just now, and now it's chilly. Bud from North Carolina thinks that this male lion is calling for his brothers. And he could possibly be calling for his brothers. Like I said, I think he's been walking the whole night too. Hang on, are you going to do a roar? He could also be waiting for the females. Remember, Jamie said this morning she had some audio of some more lions a little bit further north of us. But I hope he is looking for his brothers. Like I said, I'd love to see them all together. Right, everybody? Jamie has found the other cat that we were looking for this morning. So I hope you enjoy the spotted Tingana.
He's hunting. He's just 10 meters from that impala. You can see the impala. Oh, they've seen him. But they're not sure where he is. She's panicked. He's right there. He is right there. Let's just give it a second. They're all alarm calling. One of them spotted him, but I don't know where he is exactly anymore. That was incredible. He came so close. I'm just gonna wait here for a moment. Okay. I think that's it. I think hunt over. In this thick monkey orange, he was right up close at one point to those impala. Okay. Let's reposition. Oh, Rex, do you still have visual? Copy that, thank you. Apparently he just lay down. Perfect. So we finally caught up with him. Jeepers, he moved so quickly. So quickly, in fact, that Aubrey's commented that he's not sure it's the same leopard. Shame, boy. Just missed out on a meal. Sorry, everybody. This is a bit of a tricky spot, but we're going to be with him soon. Sure. You can barely see him. I can see him now. Can you spot him? Let's play spot the leopard. He's there. No, don't worry, I will get us a better view. So close and yet so far. There we go. With this view for now, just so that the other guests have a nice chance to see him. But there we go, the massive male leopard that is Tingana. I am whispering just because I'm parked right on top of another vehicle, not on top, obviously. There he is, and he's up. Yep, that's him. Sorry, try to move for you. Here we go. A very hungry looking Tingana. He's been occupied with honeymoon activities with Shadow, and he obviously hasn't had a meal in a while. You can see that flap of skin on his belly. Shame, that impala would have been really very welcome. Look at him, a male leopard in his prime, that massive neck. In fact, barely a neck at all. Head and shoulders. Oh, he's beautiful. Please don't reverse into me. Welcome to Monkey Orange Haven. How magnificent is that? Okay, we need to do some navigating and it gets very, very dense in here. So let's head back to Taylor, the lion woman, McCurdy.
This lion is really putting on a show, everybody. He let out one more roar a few moments ago and then he flopped onto his...
He's just been chased up a tree by a lioness. I don't believe it. She came out of nowhere. I had no idea she was here. The lioness is at the base of the tree. She tried to climb the tree after him. She just missed. Don't believe that. That was such a surprise. She just came out of nowhere. Wow. My heart's going so fast. I thought she was gonna get him. Oh my word. Whew. Look at Tingana all the way at the top of the marula tree. I cannot believe that just happened. I'm actually shaking. I got such a fright. I really thought she was gonna get him. She just came out of nowhere. She was 2 meters at the most from him. Whew. Okay, we're gonna reposition. He's okay, he's gonna be okay up there, I think. That's a little bit too much of a climb for a lioness. There she is, one of our Nkuhumas. That's unbelievable. What is it with me and things chasing leopards up trees at the moment? And you, Dave. My heart's pounding. Oh my word. She shot up that tree and then fell out. She went straight after him. She didn't even think about it. And here we have a truly African scene, a battle of the predators. She can't climb that tree and she knows it. The opportunity is lost and is that our young lioness? It is. It's our young lioness. Full-bellied. That was pure competition at work. If she'd caught him, there's no doubt she would have killed him. Young lionesses, young lions in general, are the ones that tend to initiate these hunts. Off she goes. back to, I don't even know where she came from. I have no idea. I had no idea she was here. Job done, she saunters off. Dominance established. Oh, fantastic. I was so worried that we might have missed it, but luckily the wonderful girls in Final Control have a replay of the chase. So let's just wait for her to disappear. Let's just wait for her to disappear. You can hear the Impala alarm calling as she snuffles around. Oh my word. That was utterly incredible. Phew. I wonder if she's going to come back. I wonder if Tingana's thinking the same thing. Where did you come from? She's gone? I don't even know what she's after. That was just... She's playing, basically. Her hunting instincts are triggered. And she's keeping herself entertained. She must have, that must have been something small, a steambok or a something that she just pounced for. And all the while, the Impala are alarm calling as if to say, oh, there's lions and leopards here. There's Tingana. He's up in the tree still. He's not going down anytime soon. Blinking in relief. That was incredible. Okay, we have the clip prepared for you. Final Control doing their marvelous job once again. Now let's have a look at what transpired just a few seconds ago. You see what I mean about my heart, why my heart was racing? That was absolutely astounding. Now I'm guessing the lioness has disappeared. I'm guessing that she's going to move back towards the rest of the lions. But he's still looking in that direction, so I don't think she's gone just yet. I'm not going to reposition. I'm going to just stick here for the moment and let the scenario play out. Well done, Tingana. The reflexes of a leopard strike again. Oh, shame. He looks so miserable. Oh, he looks so sad. Shame. I think if my heart is racing, his must be too. Have you ever seen Tingana look so downcast in your life? Oh, he's beautiful. Whew, I'm so glad he got up that tree. I'm so glad that tree was there. I'm not... I mean, you're not meant to take sides, of course, but it's impossible not to in a situation like that. For new viewers, what an exciting way to start off your first sunrise safari. I do hope we've got a couple of new viewers joining us along for the first time. So this is the dominant male leopard of this area, and he's pretty much as big as they get. There's one or two that are a little bit larger, but we're talking a margin of maybe a couple of kilograms, maybe 10 kilograms at the most. So he is as big as a leopard gets. Leopards are not built to be in competition with lions. Solitary and smaller and stealthier, they rely on their speed and their reflexes and their stealth to hunt and exist. Lions, all predators do that. I mean, there's nothing that young lioness did wrong. It's pure competition, it's elimination of competition, and it happens. Right, so now I have seen a Tingana up a tree with wild dogs underneath him, and not too long ago with Dave, then the next morning with hyenas underneath him, and now with a lioness underneath him. What an extraordinary start. Now he knew instinctively he had to get as high up as possible. Yes, I do. I think that's a very, very good point, Aqua. That's exactly what happened. I think the alarm calls attracted that lioness. She came to investigate what was going on. Just the direction that she came from was so surprising. The rest of the lionesses must be close to that kill that they were on yesterday. Close to Gowrie Main. Look at him, Shay. It's the most uncomfortable perch in the world. I think that lioness is still around. And he is not going to come out of this tree until he feels it's safe. Christine, you wanted to know if I have any idea how long he will stay in the tree for. No, I don't. I think he's got a really good vantage point. He can probably still see the lioness, or at least has a rough idea of where she is. And I think he's going to stay there until she is long gone. I don't think he wants to risk her returning and attempting and making another attempt on his life. Not a good start for Tingana. One missed impala hunt and one lion hunt. How was your heart rate there, Dave? Phew. I don't know if in the moment it always feels closer than it is. Oh, look at him. That's really not a comfortable position, is it? That's a very good point. Those impala are still going insane. Sorry, the lions must be walking through here. Sorry, I will get back to that Jen's comment in a moment. These impala are furious. Everywhere. We're surrounded by 180 degrees of impala alarm calls. Might not be a bad idea for Taylor to make her way around this corner. Triple M, Zoe's Road, somewhere around there. The lions are all in this area, I think. And poor Tingana strayed into the wrong neighborhood today. And the impala that survived the hunt would all have started alarm calling, and you're absolutely right, and he could well have been completely distracted. Although leopards are usually very, very good at being aware of their surroundings, they have to be. They're on one of the lowest rungs of the predator hierarchy, so they have to be aware of things like wild dogs, hyenas, and lions. The only thing that's not a threat to a leopard in terms of big predators is a cheetah. Okay, let's reposition now. We can get a little bit closer now that the action's all unfolded. I wanted to keep a little bit of distance so that we could make sure not we didn't miss anything. Sorry, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel at the same time. What an exciting morning. I'm so glad we caught up with him when we did. I'm trying to find our way through here. Okay, hold on to your paintwork. Bravo to Connor. The reason I say that is we would still have been looking around Zoe's Road if he hadn't told us where those alarm calls came from. ministry. I am whispering into my mic just because there's other guests obviously right here, so I don't want to disturb them in any way. Oh, we did have a beautiful view a second ago. Now we've got, well, a view of his bottom. How's that for a silhouette? It's like something out of a black and white photo. Very, very beautiful. And now we wait. Now we wait. Now, William, excuse me, William in Oregon, you wanted to know if it's normal for a lioness to go after a leopard, and would she be protecting the cubs? Yes, it's very normal for most, well, especially lions to go after other predators, and especially lions and leopards. Yes, a lioness would absolutely defend her cubs from a leopard, and a leopard would be a threat to lion cubs if they were left alone. In that case, though, that's not what she was doing. You see it particularly with young male lions, but females as well, obviously. When they hit a certain age, when they just reach sexual maturity, it's like they're going through puberty and they're testing their boundaries. And they often go out of their way, even more so than the older, more experienced lions, to catch predators, other predators. You see it often with hyena. Sometimes they harass rhino, even though they, I mean, that's a different story, but that's their learning. It's all part of the same example. They harass rhino, even though they can't, chances of them catching one is next to nothing. They chase cheetah. They just generally go out of their way. And if you watch them, I know we've seen the Nkuhums with tortoises before, but often you'll see they do things like try and hunt honey badger or grab tortoises. And that's not to say that other lions, adult lions, don't do it. It's just more common with the youngsters. He is not taking any chances. While he casts about and tries to figure out where those lionesses have gone, Taylor is doing something very similar. Let's see what she's found.
Now everybody, we're trying to find the rest of the Nkuhumas as well as the other Birminghams. So Jamie suggested that we come back to the old carcass. Now we are here and there are no lions. However, there are some vultures, which is quite amazing. And they're all coming back to feed on the carcass now. And this is one of my absolute favorite things to see in the bush, is to see vultures feeding, or a vulture feeding frenzy on this, on the remnants here of this buffalo carcass that the lions killed yesterday morning. So they're having little bits of disputes. Look at that, see, chasing each other around, trying to establish a pecking order. Now, I don't see any hooded vultures. I just see all these white-backed vultures, which are the most common species of vulture that we see. They're often the first ones on a kill in this area, and they've got those big, robust bills, you can see. So they are able to tear through the hide of a buffalo. Now, they obviously didn't need to worry about that here, because the lions kindly opened the entire carcass for them. So now they're just picking at the scraps. There he is, in between the ribs, picking at the sinew, getting in with to all the places that those lions possibly couldn't have reached. You see, they've got that lovely long neck, which they can poke into all sorts of orifices and reach some tasty morsels that have been left behind. Here we go. But this is incredible. Now they're all coming down, which is great. There were a few vehicles that were driving past, which startled them. And vultures are obviously, they're not as big and brave as a lion, so they are going to be quite cautious, because if another predator were to come charging in here, they will fly away. And I think they were a bit nervous of the vehicles, but now they've settled down and they're very happy with us being here, and they've started to eat again. Oh my goodness. They've sort of got a wing in the face, as poor other birds. Yeah, don't you see how cautious they are there? Are you gonna come back? Yes, I know you're gonna come back. They're staring at us now, everybody. But you were just eating on the carcass and you were happy with us. And I'm also hoping while we're sitting here that I'm going to hear those other lions. And then that will give us a better idea as to where the pride has moved off to. And how exciting that you got to see Jamie witness that Tingana being chased up a tree. I mean, that's amazing. But my favorite lioness, the youngest lioness of the Nkuhumas, I'm envious and I can't wait to watch the highlights a little bit later to see that sighting again. That is really, really special. And that's why you've got to keep watching the show, everybody. Every day, you can't miss it because everything happens so quickly and you don't know what you are going to see out in the bush. I mean, I expected to start my day off with a male leopard that we heard calling close by, and it turned out to be the complete opposite. We got a male lion calling, and now we've got some vultures on a kill. It is all happening on Duma this morning, the bustling democratic of Duma. We're very, very fortunate, this piece of land that we've got here. There's a lot of meat for these vultures to still feed on. I'm surprised there aren't any hyenas as well gnawing on some of these bones. But I think it is starting to smell. So hopefully in no time the hyenas come. Wouldn't it be great if they came charging through now and came and joined these vultures? I know we've all been itching to see. We've all been itching to see some hyenas. Everybody keeps asking about them and I have yet to see a hyena. Well, yes and no. I saw a hyena this morning after we walked out of our rooms and went down to the vehicles and put Barefoot Dave, or Downpour David, as some of you are calling him. He almost got trapped in by a hyena who was obviously coming to see if we left any scraps from last night. Now, if any of you have ever had the privilege of watching a vulture frenzy, you will know that the sounds are quite incredible. And I remember I was asked a question, what is my favorite sound in the bush? Now, the lion roars are unbelievable. The rasping of a leopard is great too. I think the most interesting sound to me has got to be the noises that come from these vultures when they all pile on top of a carcass. It sort of sounds like something out of Jurassic Park. It's quite amazing. There we go. Did you hear that, everybody? That rah, that's my vulture impression. There we go, can you hear that? All talking, communicating with each other. Now imagine that. Imagine that when you've got 50 vultures on this carcass, the sounds that will come, all fighting for a scrap. Yeah, chase them away. You see there, establishing that hierarchy. Look at the vulture hop that they do. That's quite incredible. The way that they sort of hop like that. I think I'm going to use that, and that's how I'm going to start running from now on, like a vulture. I think it will provide much entertainment around camp. I keep hearing rustling, and I'm hoping, I'm hoping and praying that it's going to be something like a hyena that comes bursting out of a thicket and straight towards this carcass. They would have an absolute feast here. See, they're sticking his head right between the skin of the buffalo. So the vultures are not going to eat the skin. They're really just looking for bits of flesh that haven't been picked off. And it's very important to have vultures around, everybody. They clean up carcasses so quickly and prevent also the spread of disease. I suppose in some way they can also spread the disease if they are defecating in water sources, so like dams or even the mud wallows that we are seeing that are now filled with water. And if something comes and drinks out of that, if they've maybe got anthrax or something along those lines, you see vultures aren't affected by anthrax. They can raise their temperatures quite high and they're actually not susceptible to quite a lot of different diseases. So if they pick that up and then they defecate it out, then those spores can be passed on via a water source, which is not that great, especially after they've had a kill like this. normally they will go to a watering hole or a puddle of water that's filled up from all the rains that we've had, and they'll actually bathe and clean themselves. That's also quite amazing to see, is to see how they become putrid and covered in all this rotting flesh, and then they go and have a lovely bath afterwards. One is not happy with that other one coming closer. Oh, we're going to very quickly head on over to Jamie and see what Tingana is up to.
We have our answer to when is Tingana going to come down. And that answer is in the next few moments. But he's doing it very, very cautiously. So just wait and see. It also might be a little bit of a case of, I got up here. I'm not quite sure how to get down, what the best way is. I don't think he was thinking when he shot up that tree, that very conveniently placed marula tree. That. Oh, actually, I've changed my mind and I'm just going to look for a more comfortable position. It's a useful vantage point, and since I'm up here now, might as well have a look. I think he wants to double check that there's no more surprise lionesses waiting for him, which is fair enough. I'd probably want to do the same. Now what? Now he shot up right to the top of the marula tree. He probably was about 9 or 10 meters up when he first made his way to the top. Liss, you were wondering how far the lioness would climb up, if she could. Sorry, guys. Sorry, Liss. I've been distracted by the Game Drive channel. Apparently Shadow was with him last night. Sorry. Okay, Liss. Sorry about that. Okay, guys, we do know that there are problems, major problems with our audio. We are desperately trying to sort it out, but unfortunately there isn't terribly much we can do. We're still trying to make a plan, but at this point we've tried pretty much every single avenue. The mic still seems to be on, and I am whispering because there are guests right next to us, but you should be able to hear me, unfortunately. It is what it is. We are sorry, we are aware. And we are working on it. Liss, you wanted to know how far up she'd go before she stopped and gave up. She could this is a hard tree to climb. I don't think she would have made it much. I don't even know if she would have made it to the first branch. Probably. That first limb over there. She might have made it there. She could. If you watch lions when they are determined, they can get up trees. They can climb trees. They're not very good at it. And they often fall down. But they do scramble up, so she might have made it to the second limb even. But definitely, definitely not all the way up to the top. I think Tingana knew that. I think he knew he was safe. Shame. You can see how nervous he still is. He's still got all of that adrenaline coursing through his body. Sharp glances in different directions. And he's still checking carefully. I don't know where that lioness went. Chose to stay with Tingana, obviously. So I have absolutely no idea where she disappeared to. Here he goes. Ooh. Oh, amazing. Imagine being able to do that. This is astounding. The ability of these animals to climb is just phenomenal. balance and poise. Right, we seem to be conducting his descent in levels. One level. Oh my gosh, there's shadow. You must be joking. She's purring at him. He's coming down to meet her. And we have the mating dance. Oh. You missed, Shadow. He's here. Look at that. The kittish dance of a leopard in estrus. Here she comes back again. And Tingana's not having any of this. He's gone. No, not you as well. Really? Oh, Shadow. Rejected. Oh, dear. Oh, dearie me. He was not interested in her. That was actually quite sad. That was painful to watch. Poor Shadow. It wasn't very polite of him at all, girl. I think you're beautiful. And he's gone. Off he goes. Now who do we stay with? Goodness gracious, this is now confusing. Morning station's just an update from our side on Voyatela. We've got Shadow and Tingana. They look like they're mobile now. I'm back. Okay. Okay, let's try and stick with them. They shot off in this direction. That was quite a painful rejection. And very interesting. Oh, goodness. Can I squeeze through here? Do you think I can? I'm gonna try. Almost. Not quite. I can't see them. Playing hide and go seek in the monkey orange. That's not good. Got him? All done. There. Where's that? Oh, there they are. Got it. I'm going to reposition. Okay, while we do, let's go across to Taylor, who's got another spotted predator.
Finally, I'm so excited, everybody. Hyenas, hyenas. It's only taken me almost 11 days to see my first hyenas live. How exciting is this? And they are probably about 80 meters west from where that carcass is, that buffalo carcass is. Come on, turn around and go the other way and you will have a feast. But I don't know if they can smell it, which is unfortunate for them, and they are now disappearing into the thicket. But we got to see some hyenas, everybody. I didn't get a good enough glimpse. It looked like it was one big female and a male, but now, sadly, they are disappearing. Ah, they would have had, I just wish I could speak animal, everybody, and then I could have told these hyenas that they could have had an amazing feast. Let's go back to that carcass, though. Let's just have one more look at those vultures. Maybe we get lucky and some hyenas have turned up. Oh, what a pity. This is where it's so important and that the animals use their sense of smell. And unfortunately, I think for that hyena, the wind is blowing in the wrong way. So they have absolutely no idea that this carcass is even here. Maybe they picked up on the lion's scent and are trying to figure out why they've been hanging around. Lake wants to know if a lion or any other predator, I'm under some power lines, so the communication is slightly distorted this morning. So Lace wants to know, if a lion or any other predator were to catch a vulture, would they eat it or would they just kill it? Now, it's a bit difficult. I'm trying to have a look here through these trees to see these vultures that have all perched themselves up on this dead tree. Now, Lace, I've never seen it personally where predators have caught vultures. However, I've seen footage of young lions at a watering hole chasing and catching vultures. And then they did eat them. So I know where you're going with that question. So I think where Lace is, the direction that she's heading in, is that typically lions and leopards will kill other predators, but they normally don't feed on them. They will just leave them alone. Now, a hyena eats anything and everything. It'll even eat its own kind if it has died off. They don't let anything go to waste. They are the real cleanup crew in the bush, and the same goes for the vultures. They eat anything and everything. So, Elise, I'm not 100% sure, but like I said, I've seen it on one set of footage where a young lion caught a vulture, a young male lion, in fact, and it then was eaten. If it was not mistaken, I think it was in Botswana somewhere. So it does happen. I don't know how frequently it happens. I think they would prefer to go for something like an antelope or a buffalo. But I suppose if you're a young lion just starting out, you'll catch and eat anything, I suppose, to survive. Now, look at those full crops. Can you see them there? That sort of looks like a big ball on the chest of this vulture. Now, they've done eating. They are nice and full. They're going to sit there and let that all digest and roost up in the tree. Let's go forward again just to have one last look and see what's happening on the carcass. Boys just scanning around here because I don't know where these lions have gone, everybody. But I am keeping an eye out. Actually, we may have one very good view, which will make for a very nice screensaver, everybody. We've got a clearing now of these vultures with that very dark, dramatic sky in the background. And all of them perched up here. Isn't that beautiful? And I think that's the perfect picture for a vulture. It's on a dead tree with a grey, dark sky in the background. It makes them almost look evil. And I think we have to say thanks to the Lion King for making vultures seem like they are evil creatures. Well, that's what I remember growing up. And that's not the case. Oh, our friend is on the termite mound again, Eggsy. We had a beautiful capture of one of the hooded vultures sitting perched up onto the termite mound. So we're going to see if we can find that angle again. It was beautiful. And that was actually quite an amazing picture. So let's see if we can get that little angle again. Quite difficult. Just sneak past you. Hello. Okay, Eggsy, you've got to tell me when to stop so we get that perfect angle again. Forward, maybe a little there. Yep. Let's try him. And it's really beautiful the way this vulture has actually sat on the termite mound. There we go. Good morning, dark tranquility. Sorry, tongue-tied again this morning. So you would like to know, how does the vulture hierarchy work? Now, there are different species of vultures that we get, and the common ones that we see is the one that we're looking at now, the white-backed vulture, and then you get the hooded vulture, which are normally around two. You get a lappet-faced vulture, and occasionally we see the white-headed vulture, but those aren't too common, I'm afraid. And what happens then is how the hierarchy works is obviously size does matter in the bush. So a lappet-faced vulture would take the lead and obviously come through and probably chase everybody else off and eat their feed. And then you may get a white-headed if they were around, but it's very uncommon that the white-headed vultures will be around. So we've got lots of vehicles coming through, so I'm going to draw attention to me this morning. Hello. And just let everybody get past. We are on a
are on a cut line. Sorry, everybody. Nobody wants to go past me this morning. Everyone's being too courteous. Actually, we just want them to zip on away. That's one of the transfer companies, obviously, fetching guests from a lodge and taking them away. So they're probably on their way home now. And then after you've got the white-headed vulture, then you will get the white-backed, which is slightly smaller, and then the hooded falls right down below there. Now, it all depends on, has the carcass been opened already, or is it still closed? If it's a buffalo that's died of natural causes, say due to the drought that we have been experiencing, and it's not open in any way. And I have mentioned this before, so for those of you who have heard this, it's always good just to hear it once or twice after that. I love talking about vultures. So if it's a closed carcass, you'll get the hooded, who normally fly at lower levels than the other vultures. The same thing with the bateleurs, the tawny eagles, and whichever other bird of prey is flying around. They'll normally come down on the carcass first. Now, they don't have big, robust beaks. They've normally got very sharp, recurved beaks. And they can't pierce open that tough hide that a buffalo has. Now, we're just talking about a buffalo carcass. Yeah, this is the example that I'm using. So they're going to have to start eating the eyes. They're going to have to start eating around the nose, maybe even the tongue, and go right in towards the rump and start feeding on the anus itself. Obviously, that tissue is quite soft and it's exposed quite nicely. Now you're going to have to... I'm going to reposition just because it's not a great view. And go back to the carcass so we can watch them eat. Where's the nice little spot? And once something like either the white-backed or a leopard-faced or a white-headed comes down, they will then, and you can, maybe Eggsy, you can show them how robust their beaks are. You can see that big sort of bulk of beak on the face there. Now that beak is able to tear open the hide of the buffalo. So those hooded vultures and the tawny eagles and the bateleurs will have to wait for either a white-backed or a white-headed or a leopard face to come through and then open the carcass that way. Normally how it works in this area is it's leopard, white-backed, hooded, and then all the smaller raptors that you see that come through as well. So I hope that answers your question, but it's quite amazing, especially when you've got an area where you've got quite a few different species of vulture that are quite common. If you get something like an elephant dying, that's obviously going to draw a lot of attention from all the different species of vultures, and then you could possibly find that you maybe get the white-headed and the leopards coming down. But to see a leopard-faced vulture, that is quite special. Same thing with the white-headed. There we go, feeding away. But you can see there's no sort of sense of urgency to feed on this carcass. There's no hyenas or anything around, so they're just nibbling and eating as much as they can and then flying up to the trees and perching themselves where they'll let all that food digest. Come on, eat away. There you see that one stuck its head right in. And also notice how there's very few feathers around on the head. And that is so that they can stick their necks in quite far and reach all the little bits that have been missed. Here we go, going right in, except that bone is obstructing you, the bone between his wings. Well, I don't know if it's a male or female. There you go, in you go again. Here we go, that's so if you close your wings, you can go through that little gap much easier. I think everybody must be sort of glued to their seats this morning with all the action that is going on. Just around every single corner, something is happening. Aaron from New Zealand. I'm so sad that you are not going to be able to watch us for a week. So Aaron says that this is the last sunrise safari that he is able to watch for an entire week. You're going to be itching when you come back from wherever you are going, if you're going on a trip. But remember, you can always watch the highlights. So you can go to the Facebook page and of Safari Live, and you're welcome. Oh, sorry, I'm a bit confused. Obviously, I'm still sleeping this morning.
Aaron, I suppose we do. We're expecting the Mara sort of drives, our long 7-hour drives coming up soon, and that makes a little bit more sense. My brain is not working too well. So remember, everybody, from tomorrow, we're not going to be doing any sunrise drives. We're going to be starting in the afternoon, but it's going to be exciting because we're going to be doing drives well into the darkness of the night and have an opportunity to try and find some of those special creatures that we normally don't get to see. So like the elusive aardvark, which Jamie has never seen. So keep your fingers crossed, and it's a perfect opportunity for her to be able to try and find one now, especially just after the rains and hopefully the weather warms up. We're going to be looking for things like civets and like I said, the aardvark, honey badgers, bush babies, all those wonderful little creatures. So Aaron, I don't think it's too much of a bad thing that we're going to have a little rest from the morning safaris. A lot of things happen when everybody else goes to bed. It's like the animals here have learnt game drive times. Sometimes I find that during the times we don't normally go out, we see amazing things. I wonder if we can have one more look of this vulture on the termite mound. It's starting to groom itself, which is quite nice. Got its wings splayed open. Let's see if we can find a little gap here. Where are you? There's lots of monkey orange around here, which is proving quite difficult to see this vulture. I have to go back. Eggsy, you have to tell me when you've got a gap. Good one. There. Is that good? There we go. Teamwork, everybody. With the Eggsy's a little bit further behind me. And I want him to have the best. There we go. So if he has the best view, that means then you have the best view at home. So you can see this vulture had its wings opened much wider. So I think hopefully it'll do it again. And it was preening and grooming all the feathers. Come on, open your wings so we can see your wingspan. They've got a massive wingspan, the white-backed vultures. It's about anywhere between 1.5 and 1.7 meters, which is quite large. Very quiet, no hyenas calling. Haven't heard the lions calling again. So we'll do a little drive around, one more look to see if we can find the rest of the pride. And if we don't get lucky, then possibly we will return to Blondie, one of the Birmingham boys, and see if he's still laying about. Now I was very confused because I had, on our way towards this carcass, I had very fresh male lion tracks going up and down the road, and I'm thinking that it is, and which basically led all the way to where Blondie is laying. So I think he's just been walking around trying to find everybody and kept missing them. Possibly he even came and scavenged on this buffalo carcass, and that's why he's got a full belly. And now he's just looking for the rest of the pride, and maybe they are in a very thick block, and that's why we haven't seen them. They're probably laying down, just resting, sleeping off their full bellies. There we go, you can see this one grooming away. Pull, oh, that feather was obviously old and it needs to come out. This kind of reminds me of my mom when I was a young girl and she used to brush my hair. And sometimes I'd have a little, like a strange color hair, like a gray hair or something. She always used to pull it out of my head. I don't know why, but I can imagine that's what that must have felt like when that bird pulled out that old feather. Just glancing at us, making sure we're not plotting an attack. No, nothing. You're not interested in us. We're just watching you, watching us. Lovely. Oh, I got excited. I thought that I heard something in the distance. It just seems to be another vehicle revving. So Jason wants to know if I have any idea when we will be expecting baby vultures. And they should start breeding now, if I'm not mistaken. Let me just have a look in the book. Let's open the bird book. Like I said, I don't want to feed you incorrect information, and I'm not 100% sure, but I thought that they had started laying their eggs already. Let's look at the white-backed vulture, seen as we are talking about them. Let's see. Yes, they say that they do start breeding now, sort of August, September. So they are probably a month or two after that, we might start seeing little ones. So apparently there's an active nest on Arethusa, and maybe we'll have to take a drive down towards Arethusa one afternoon or one morning, possibly one afternoon. Maybe that's something we can do tomorrow, to go and find this nest and see if it is active, because I've never found it before. So I'll ask Jamie where we need to go, and then possibly Jason, I'll be able to follow up on your question for you. How does that sound? Tomorrow afternoon, so hopefully you watch, and then we can go and do a bit of investigating. Amazing. Right, everybody, I think we're going to try and find out where the lions are. So let's go back, and we're going to go to Jamie and... Ooh, no, that doesn't sound good. Let's go to Jamie and see how those leopards are doing.
What a beautiful morning. Heavy clouds, it's looking absolutely lovely. We just wanted to have a look at the sky and the stunning scenery that we have in front of us after all the excitement of the morning. So, Shadow and Tingana crossed into Arethusa. I gave up my spot in the sighting to make way for other vehicles. However, I'm going to hang around the area, and hopefully we can go back towards the end of the sunrise safari once everyone's had a chance to have a look, just to keep you updated. Oh no. Oh dear. Oh goodness. We good? Okay, nobody move. It's a good thing I don't need to move at all. Just to keep you updated on the situation, Shadow did eventually manage to get Tingana's attention despite his best efforts, and they did mate twice while we were just waiting for them to go across. So she did have success there. There's nothing like a female leopard. They don't take no for an answer, really, even when the male runs away, as a Tingana did. It was quite an interesting sighting. I think he's hungry, and I think they've been mating for a long time. In Cat in Tampa, you're wondering if perhaps a cat portal had opened, and the cats were just streaming in from every which direction. Absolutely. Quite astounding, really. We've had unbelievable sightings. We've been incredibly fortunate. That's the nice thing as well about rain. And speaking of rain, I'm just wondering, we're okay for now. We're starting to get the odd raindrop. Dave, let me know if you need to pop the camera cover on. I'm not going to complain. A couple of drops of rain never hurt anyone. And for the bush, it is absolutely necessary. And what's so perfect about this rain at the moment is that it's gradual. It's gentle. It's not washing away any topsoil. The thirsty ground can just soak it up. It is marvelous. I'm very curious to see. There is a sighting with the two males and the female. We were there yesterday with their baby buffalo kill, and they are still there this morning. And I'm curious to see. I'm going to let Taylor take that if she wants to. I haven't called myself in, but if she'd like to go and take that sighting, she's welcome to. And I'm very curious to see if it's that young lioness that we just saw chasing Tingana, because I think she might have got up and gone for a little bit of a walk, maybe investigated. Because yesterday it was the young lioness with the two males, and after we left you at the end of the sunset safari, Dave and myself stayed behind for a little bit longer just to do some testing of various equipment, because as Taylor's been telling you, we have exciting things planned, which is why my car looks like something out of Back to the Future with its two fantastic lights in the front. Unfortunately, just the wrong angle to show you, so I can't show you what they look like, but it's very fancy. So we stayed out to test how we're going to manage this and what we're going to do, and the male kept going up to the female and Fleming grimacing and scent testing her to see whether or not she was ready to mate. And at one point he just pushed it too far, and she turned round and gave him such a walloping We've seen it with the lionesses, how they can turn around and they just get so angry and they batter the males, and the males get this, what did I do, expression on their face, and kind of backing up and half snarling, not quite sure what to do with themselves. Well, I think it was the young lioness, wasn't Amber Eyes, and that was, unless I'm very much mistaken, and I know you guys are all probably taking screenshots, I think that was that young lioness again that chased Tingana up the tree. In fact, I know it was the young lioness that chased Tingana up the tree. So there we go. I wonder if she's back there now. Apparently, Aubrey's had tracks of the lioness with cubs, at least one lioness with cubs in this area, so we're also just checking it out, making sure that they're, we haven't missed a chance to see them. Hello, Impala. Looking a bit chilly. Looking very dark red this morning, as they are wont to do on a chilly summer morning. But they won't have a hole in its neck. No, the one that walked behind the tree. It does too. What do we think? Fight, probably, most likely. Another impala. They're not rutting at the moment, but they are occasionally crashing horns and sparring. You can see a little bit jumpy every time another male walks past. And definitely very puffed up and a bit cold. Oh, let's go watch that. I hope they keep doing it. Oh, we've got a response. Where? Okay, hold on. Territorial conversation happening between two green wood hoopoe groups, or possibly just communication between one group. I'm hoping we get to keep going. Aw. The joys of live wildlife filming. Where's the second group? Can hear them. Oh, now the babblers have started. All having a wonderful time. Let's see if we can't see them again. So that was green wood hoopoes. And the reason why I wanted to, was so desperate to show you them, is when they do that display, they rock backwards and forwards in this way that actually gives them the nickname, the cackling old woman. Like they're howling with laughter. There they are. Can you see them there, Dave? They're in the dark tree at the back. The dark tree at the back. That possibly wasn't the best description. Oh, yes, left a little. And go in there. There they are. Well done. Full of the joys of spring. There's a juvenile being fed by the adult with its dark beak. Doesn't have the red bull. Oh, and somebody popping in to join in the fun. Oh no, it does have the red bull. So two juveniles they've got there. Awesome. Oh, and we're all gone. Spring has sprung, and all of the birds are chirping merrily away. We've come upon a bird party. Let's try it. Can you sort of get in there, Dave? Oh, now the Franklins have started. What else can we find? The babblers are going off. It's interesting to see how the calls of the wood hoopoes, it started with the green wood hoopoes, or the red-billed wood hoopoes as they used to be known, now translated into a whole lot of birds calling. The babblers were calling just here, but let's have a look at the Franklin. Maybe they're going to give us a call. in response to the others. Oops, sorry. And the dawn chorus is a way of, well, it's a little bit past the time of the dawn chorus, but it's basically the different groups telling each other where they are, that they're here, the males testifying to their dominance. And for my own curiosity, I want to see what the book says about the call. Hello, Crested Franklin. Ah, harsh chattering and cackling. That's not as exciting as I thought. One very drenched looking Crested Franklin. Luckily, they are covered in preen oil that comes from the preen gland. So a lot of the time when they're... Oh! Lovely. So what that Franklin just said was, good morning, I am here. We are here, actually, there's two of them. We are here. Where are you? And then the other groups of Crested Franklin in the area respond. They're not strictly territorial, but they do have home ranges that they move about in. They only really fight, and they can have serious fights, when there is a female that two males are fighting over. But other than that, they live relatively peaceful lives. That conversation was just to say, where's everybody else? We are here. Hello. It's the bird equivalent of posting a Facebook status saying good morning. Because it reaches, it's not like a message saying good morning, because it actually reaches across to different groups of Franklin. There we go. How lovely. And now all has gone quiet. With pleasure, James Richard. I will check the bird book and have a look at how it describes the white-browed scrub robin, which is James's favourite book. No, bird, not book. No, I'm pretty sure scrub robin is under scrub robin in this book. That might sound like a silly thing to say. 458. But in some books, they are under just robins. The white-browed scrub robin. A harsh drrr, alarm note, fluty but repetitive song. That's a bit rude. I don't think it's repetitive at all. A characteristic call at dawn and dusk is whittled seep pogo. Seep pogo. Seep pogo, seep pogo pogo. Maybe that's what they mean. So there you go, James. Seep pogo. As written, bird calls as described by ornithologists. I'm not meaning any disrespect to ornithologists. I have absolutely no idea how I would go about doing that. Right, Taylor the Lion Whisperer McCurdy is at it again. Let's head across to her and see what she's got in store for you.
After much searching, I think Aubrey managed to find this Birmingham with a female. There's actually a second Birmingham here too, but unfortunately he is lying in the distance and we can't get a good view of him. So they are at that carcass from yesterday still, that young buffalo calf. We're not too far away from where we had the vultures. We must have just missed them this morning. I wasn't aware of where this kill was, but that's great. So I'm a little bit confused at the moment because our friend Blondie, who we had calling so nicely this morning, he had a very big belly and I saw a lovely male lion tracks coming down this road, down Philemon's cut line and all the way towards quarantine, going down on the one side and coming back up on the other. I'm not sure what happened if he came and he fed on this carcass, but then why would he be calling if he knows exactly where the rest of the pride is? That's quite bizarre to me, because it was definitely his tracks. I don't think either of these two males would have moved too far away from this carcass. So it's quite interesting. So these chaps are obviously not going anywhere. So that other male lion, Blondie, can call and call as much as he likes. And all he's going to get is a sore throat, because they would not want to risk and move out of this area, because they're obviously going to lose their buffalo calf to some hyenas or possibly some other lions as well. But they are sleeping, doing my least favorite thing. There we go, lift your head. But what they'll keep doing, and what I'm hoping they will do, is if we sit here for a little bit, remember patience is key, is that one of them gets a second wind and finds a gap in those already bloated stomachs to munch away on this buffalo calf again, which would be quite exciting for us. A little bit cold again. The clouds have now lifted quite a bit, and that has allowed for all the cold air to come in. This morning the clouds were blanketed across the sky, and it was so beautiful. It was lovely and warm, and there's a bit of a wind that's picking up again too. You can just see that the female is fast asleep. David from Napa, thank you very much for the encouragement. David says that the second rain dance worked. We didn't get too much rain last night, unfortunately, David. Just a few spits. I'm actually not sure how many mils we got. It was on and off pretty much the entire evening. By about 10 o'clock, the clouds sort of lifted quite a bit, and it warmed up nicely. The wind finally dropped. And I was so excited this morning, thinking that we're going to have a dry morning. And just before we started drive, a little shower came down, and then it stopped again. And now it's spitting on and off. So every now and then you may see Eggsy bring a cloth across the screen, across the front of the lens, sorry, just to give it a wipe and make sure that it is nice and clean and you have no obstructed views. Can you hear the helmet shrikes in the background? Let's see. If they're going to call again. Oh, now, of course, now that I've said that, they're going to stop. But I'd like to try and hear Jamie read out a Retz's helmet shrike call, because they make a strange noise. I'm not even going to attempt to do it. Awesome. Once this vehicle moves out, I think we're going to try and steal their spot. There we go. Let's go a little bit further forward. Well, that's nice. Going to go again forward, everybody, just because we have a gap, and if he does start munching on that carcass, hopefully we'll be able to see it too. Yeah, that woke you up. Normally they don't mind us driving over a few leaves. Can we have a look at his face quickly? Around his mouth, he's got lots of cuts on him. Can you see that? This is not our friend who unfortunately had what we think could have been an abscess that had burst. What is on this one's face, though? This is the different one. Oh, by the way, we have dubbed the lion with the hole in his face. His name is now Maggie, because of all the maggots that were found in his face. So this just looks like fresh wounds. Maybe, unfortunately, also been swatted by the ladies. They don't seem to enjoy the Birminghams too much. But maybe we'll try and go around at some point as well and try and have a look and see if we can see Maggie. Can we just show everybody that Maggie is around? But Maggie is hiding behind all the trees. You can see him there? Good morning, Ashka. I will send your regards to Maggie. So Ashka says that they hope that this Birmingham male that had the injury on his face is feeling a little bit better. And I'm sure he will. He's got a huge belly, so it can't be bothering him too much if he's still carrying on eating. The first thing that the animals often do, I mean, you see it at home with your pets, is that when they're not feeling well, they stop eating. Now, that has not stopped that male lion. Got some vultures coming in as well, sitting around here. It's sort of something out of a horror scene, because we're, like I said, we're not too far away from the old big buffalo carcass, and there are vultures spread out between where we are and all the way down to the main road. But I like vultures. What I am nervous of is crows. One day in the afternoon, I was sitting and I was talking about a tree. I forget which tree it was. And as I was telling my guests about this particular tree, I think it was about 30 crows and a combination of crows and ravens came through, and they landed on the tree that I was talking about. Now that was eerie, everybody. Turned around and said to my guests, right, we're out. We're not hanging around here. Because any horror movie that I've seen, nothing good happens when the crow lands. Now I'm going to put my head underneath the branch. That can't be very comfortable. No, surely you're not enjoying that. But hopefully, like yesterday, these animals are taking a break from all of the flies. They haven't swatted their tails once since we've been here. Lots and lots of vultures flying, and we've just had a hooded vulture land. A white-backed vulture land. There are a few hooded vultures, but we can't see them too nicely. They're hidden behind all the branches on these marula trees. And they're just peacefully sitting here, sleeping. Just, I'm plotting my move as to how we can get around to see Maggie. I think we're going to have to go through a few little branches. We'll see Rexon is heading on out, so we'll wait for him to move out. And then once Drexon is gone, we're going to try and reposition and actually head around towards Maggie. Right, I think Jamie has got one of the most special raptors out in the bush. Go and have a look at that feathery friend she's found.
Got an amazing sighting of this harrier hawk. It's being mobbed by a lilac-breasted roller. It's gone flushed in the face and pink-faced. Usually their faces are yellow, but this one's gone all pink as a result of the lilac-breasted roller's attentions. These are absolutely incredible birds. They are nest raiders, specialized raptors, that instead of ambushing their prey down on the ground or something similar like eagles do, they crawl along the trees just like this one, and they dig in the holes. Look at the way it's investigating the different spots underneath dead bark, holes in trees. They love the dead trees because that's where a lot of animals live. It's known as an African harrier hawk or a gymnogene, and they are definitely one of my top five birds of prey, just because they are so fascinating to watch. Their specially adapted legs, look at him, you could see the intense focus. Anything in this tree? Shame, a little bit ruffled as well. There you can see the pink flush starting to fade a little bit, and the face going back to yellow again. Anything here? Nope. Now casting about for the next tree target. There it goes. And it's going to go there. Perfect. Okay, that's going to be the best view I can get for now. The drongos have just come in for the attack. I'm seeing them. There he goes. Mobbing. Know that they're faster and more agile than this bird of prey, so they're trying to chase it away. And what's fascinating to watch about a situation like this is how, even if the bird isn't nesting in that particular tree, they all band together to help rid themselves of the attentions of the harrier hawk. Where'd it go? Down onto the ground again. It's the second time I've seen that recently. Where did it go? I don't want to reposition just yet in case we miss it, but I'm going to have to. Can you see it? I can't see it. Okay, let's go forward. They're fascinating birds to watch. We've seen one catch a... Oh, there he goes. There he, oh, behind the termite mound, okay? Let's try again. We've seen one catch a bush baby before, Gendre and myself. And then once, one very memorable occasion, one flew out from a tree over my head with a 1 meter snake dangling from its talons. Oh, I think it's just gone too far. I think it's gone to that marula tree at the back. I'll keep trying. And Anna Marie was saying it's lovely to see a harrier hawk, since it's been some time since we last saw one. I agree. And whenever I can, I'm more than happy to spend as long as possible with them, just because watching them is so fascinating. And you get the interaction with the other birds. Oh dear, but unfortunately, I don't think that's going to be an option. Whoopsie. I'm so busy looking, I went straight off the road. It's all right. Nope. I'm sorry. It has flown away. I don't think it would have gone far. They go from marula tree to marula tree and dead tree to dead tree. And they usually go to the nearest one. I wonder if it's not in the one with all the leaves over there. The only one with all the leaves. Let's just have a look. I can't see anything. That would have been the next obvious target, I would have thought. But no. No luck. Oh well. It was a brave attempt, but it has flown away. Let's head back to Taylor because I'm sure you're all as curious as I am, or as concerned as I am, to find out how that injury on the Birmingham boy is doing.
We found Maggie. We managed to maneuver around to get a view, but unfortunately he has got his head with his sort of cheek facing on the ground, the concerned cheek. And hopefully he'll lift his head for us, and then we can see what's actually going on. Now, you go into his face again. His entire face has been swollen over the last few days, unfortunately. But I think that's just because of the wound that's on the other side that's causing just a little bit of swelling. But I think he'll be all right. These animals are so resilient and so tough. But I think it's clever of him to keep his face on the ground like that so that no other flies can creep on in and lay any more eggs in there. And I believe it was quite gruesome to see all those maggots moving around, but hopefully they pop on out and then it will let the wound heal. I've never actually seen another animal with sort of maggots while it's still been alive in it before. I've heard of it, and it's quite a sensitive area on the face, but he's got a big belly, so it can't be causing him too much discomfort. I mean, look at him, he's quite happy laying fast asleep with his big beach ball like belly. He's just going to rest, and like I said, they're going to change between all of them, or the others. Birmingham is up now, and just keep feeding on the carcass whenever they get a second wind. What's going on there? Just have a look. We've got an obstructive view. We're going to have to reposition again, everybody. Good morning, Ellen from Arkansas. Ellen wants to know, if a lion is sick and injured, will the pride leave it behind, or what's sort of the next step from there? Now, they I think they will just leave it behind. They're not going to come back in and give it any food, unfortunately. It's going to have to keep it. It doesn't mean that they necessarily have to hunt all the time. they would be able to rely on the others to hunt, and they just need to be able to keep up and be in the area where there's food around. I've seen that happening quite a bit. We had a female in the Southern Pride in the Southern Sands, where she injured her paw quite badly, and for a number of months she wasn't able, unfortunately, to keep up and help bring down large prey species. So she just used to lurk in the back, and once the team had brought an animal down, she would then come in and feed on whatever they'd kill. Then they were actually killing lots of waterbuck, and the pride seemed to be quite content with that. They weren't bothered that she wasn't doing too much of the work. She was also the only one that had cubs as well, but now quite a few different members have got cubs. They're not eating, unfortunately. I thought that the others were going to get up and start eating, but that other Birmingham is hot on the heels of the female that's with him. She's obviously going to come into estrus soon, so he's making sure that he stays very close by, that he can mate with her first. Them there. You could drive past here and not even know that they're there. Jojo, good morning, and I agree with you. Jojo says that the Birmingham with the injured face needs to have some ox pickers come through and take a look at that wound. I agree. Pick out all the maggots, so that'd be quite nice. And but remember, with the ox pickers, they can sometimes cause more damage. They often keep wounds open rather than allowing them to heal. So that's sort of the catch 22 situation that the animals have. Is yes, they're great and they remove all those pesky parasites. However, when they do have a gash of some sort, they tend to pick at that wound, which is not ideal. They want it to scab and close, especially in this case. But I really hope that he would lift his head for us, just so we could have a little look, just to see that he is doing okay. But remember, everybody, we won't intervene here. We let nature take its course. This is the wild. So if he is going to succumb to an injury like that, that is highly... I think he'll be all right. But if it does... it's just one of those things, I'm afraid. The toughest will survive. It's like with the other Birmingham that got gored by a buffalo. It was the risk he took, and he knew that it is risky taking down an animal like a buffalo. It's so nice just to see their manes developing so nicely. It'll be exciting to see what they look like in another 6 months' time, to see if any of their manes go nice and dark. The rain is starting to come down again. Not too hard, just little sprinkles. Clouds are quite high, so I don't think we're going to get any more downpours today, though it would be lovely during dries if we could get another downpour. And don't worry, everybody, I haven't forgotten about the photo that we are doing every single day on quarantine. Just before we end drive, we will head back around to that area and do our little screenshots to compare over the next few days how quickly the grass comes through. I've just been waiting for the light to improve, and it finally is starting to improve. It was very dark and dingy this morning. The birds are happy though. I can hear lots of turtle doves in the distance. I think it's probably too far away from you. You can hear the emerald spotted wood doves. I heard a few hornbills cluckering away earlier. While the lions just sleep peacefully. I think we're going to go back and try and watch those others. The Nanake. It's a very clever sort of thing that you've thought of there. So Nanake thinks that because this male is now obviously laying down with a sore part of his face on the ground. Surely it can't be causing him too much pain. And I agree. If the animals won't do anything if it's going to cause him too much discomfort. So I think it's a combination of two things. I think he has got it down on the ground to prevent anything else from crawling in there, like a fly, because obviously now he's got the wound, it's closed on the ground. And yes, I don't think it's causing him too much pain as well. I often used to see it with my horses, where it usually happened right before a competition, where my horses in the morning, they'd be lame. They could hardly walk. I mean, it's like a great tragedy, and you'd always panic. And then you'd call the farrier, and the farrier would come through, and he'd do a few tests, and it was often something just like an abscess. And all he would do is that they would find where the abscess was in the foot and get it to pop and push out all that mucky stuff. And then the horse, 5 minutes later, was completely sound again. So I think it's the same thing has happened here. I think it was a female that swiped him across the face, and I think it just got infected, unfortunately, and then did form an abscess, and then it burst at some point yesterday, because when we saw him yesterday morning, the hole was still very small. We didn't get a good view. I don't think all the viewers got a good view, but Eggsy and I managed to have a quick look when there was a little gap, and that was still tiny. It was very swollen, so at some time during the drives, that wound burst open and all that yucky stuff came out. And now I think he's fine. Now it's just we have to wait and hope that it just heals nicely. And hopefully with the cool weather, like I said, it's the insects aren't really around at the moment, so that's good for him. While he's got that big gape in his face, hopefully it'll get some time to heal. Hopefully those maggots have also all fallen out, all gone out now. And you don't want them to fester in there. But I think we need to reposition. We'll have one last look at the one Birmingham and his female companion. They are also sleeping though. Let's try and turn around quickly. I'm just gonna head on around. Everybody, I'm just making sure that they don't get up and move. I don't want to disturb them too much. I'm just going to creep over slowly. We need to just watch the antenna over here. All right, let's head over to Jamie and see what's happening on her side.
Much is happening here on my side, but I am just enjoying our incredibly vocal. Yeah. How's that? Oh dear. Am I back? Okay. Let's try that again. I am definitely enjoying how vocal all of the birds are being. I'm a virtual starling making a lot of noise. And very good point from X-Ranger. They wouldn't use Facebook, they would use Twitter. Touché, I should have thought of that myself. The spring is most definitely in the air, and I think the birds are all rejoicing the fact that... Come sit. Hey, it's a purple roller. There it is, there. The fact that we've had some rain, there's an insect boon in the waiting. There's a purple roller. We don't often get to see them. We see the lilac-breasted rollers far more frequently. A little bit more dull, I suppose, in colouring, but still beautiful. And obviously predominantly purple, as the name suggests. Although I'd call it more a sort of an indigo. And Benji in Los Angeles, it's lovely to hear from you on this glorious sunrise safari. You wanted to know why the lilac-breasted roller has the word roller in its name. And hopefully, Benji, if you keep watching, we will actually be able to give you a demonstration of why it's called a roller. It's because they roll. Now, unlike the starlings that, and I'll explain what I mean because that sounds ridiculous, unlike our chirping starling, part of the mating display or threat display of a roller to another male roller or to attract a lady is to stretch out their wings, and then they do this. It's almost like they've lost control of their flight and they roll from side to side to side. Oh, he's gone. Where'd he go? I was distracted. So I'll give you a demonstration using my arms because it's still not quite making sense the way that I'm describing it. They do this as they fly. Ow. My pack's cold. Didn't appreciate that first thing in the morning. So there you go. That's where the name roller comes from. They roll. And hopefully we'll have a chance to see it. It's one of the more challenging things to film for our cameramen because they do it so fast and they move in quite an unpredictable manner. And almost invariably, if we ask, you know, if we put it on screen, by the time we get across to us, it's over. So we have something we have to find live. We have to catch them doing it live. But I'll keep an eye out for you, Benji, I promise. I did actually see two of them doing it this morning, but again, they were far away and we just couldn't get it on camera on time. We'll watch out for that and we'll try and give you a demonstration that's slightly better than mine sitting in the seat of the car. Okay, let's see what other birds we can find since the birds are so very active this morning. Slowly but surely making my way back towards a shadow in Tingana. There's still a queue, and we'll have to wait our turn. We've already enjoyed that sighting for a considerable period of time this morning. I'm not going to rush in there. We'll wait until everybody's had a chance for their guests to enjoy it, and then we'll move in. I'm too scared to touch anything in case it makes it worse. Is it better or worse, Dave? Okay, for now. I am sorry about our audio issues. I thought about driving over the mic, but apparently I'll get into trouble for that. So we can't do that. It's not a solution. We have tried all things possible. I've got one more trick up my sleeve I'm going to try later, but we'll test it after we finish the sunrise safari. As we trundle along the western edge of Juma, let's head all the way back to the southwestern corner where Taylor is sitting with those lions.
So if you've just tuned in to Safari Live, we are sitting with one of the Birminghams and one of the female lionesses from the Nkuhuma pride. We're not sure where the rest of the Nkuhumas are, and we had an interesting experience, and it only lasted a few seconds, where the female shuffled around a little bit, and this male, this Birmingham male, is obviously showing quite a bit of interest in this female. I thought it obviously seems like possibly she's coming into estrus and he's quite keen to be the first one to mate with her. Now, she shuffled towards the carcass. Did he not have an absolute heart attack? He growled at her and did not allow her to get anywhere near it. You can see how he's completely using his body to shield the carcass from her. Now, I think that's a bit rude. I think if he's wanting to entice this lovely lady, he should be nice and share his food with her. But that doesn't seem to be the case. But we'll see. Maybe it happens again. He looks exhausted. She keeps moving around a little bit. She's up and she's down, she's looking over her shoulder. Possibly she's wondering where the rest of the pride has gone. And we are not sure where the rest are. Like, I don't think they would be too far away. I think they're somewhere around here between where Jamie found Tingana this morning and where we are now. Maybe they're just in this big block. Yeah. Lions actually leaning up against that rotting carcass. and still using his branch as a headrest. Having a little scratch as well. Can hear the turtle dove calling. I think this would be quite nice to listen to. No, and now this turtle dove has obviously stopped calling just because I mentioned how beautiful its voice sounded. It's still sitting in the tree. I don't know if you can see it. It's quite hard to see it through all the branches on the marula trees that are growing in this area. But maybe it will call for us again. There we go. Can you all hear that? I'm sure you should be able to hear this lovely call. It sounds like this one is actually saying, sleep harder, just in connection with the lions. Come on, lioness, jump up again so we can see a little bit of action this morning. That's the thing about the bush, is that we could sit here for 3 hours. There we go, she's going to yawn. There we go. Nice yawn for us. Thank you. We could sit here for 3 hours and watch them sleep. And then when you get sick of it and you think, they're not going to do anything, you leave. And I can tell you right now, 5 minutes after you've left, they will all change and they'll all put their dancing shoes on and do something amazing when we're not here watching them. That's why I think these long drives that we're going to be doing is going to be quite interesting. I think it's going to be lots of fun trying to look for some of the nocturnal creatures. I think it could be a little bit quiet as well, because you don't always see lots at night. But maybe we get one of those hot nights, and I'm going to keep saying this, one of those nights when the termites release all their alates, all their princes and princesses, the flying ants, if you'd like to call them that. And then we are going to see amazing things. What are you looking at? Good morning, Gretchen. Gretchen is hoping to see some porcupine when we do our night drives. Wouldn't that be great? Now, that's something you're going to have to pay attention for, is when we are doing these night drives, you're going to have to sit and watch your screen very carefully, because often when we do see these nocturnal creatures, it's normally just a quick glimpse of them. They're quite shy, which is obviously one of the reasons that they come out under the cover of darkness. They don't feel too comfortable during the day, so you've got to watch very quickly. You may just see a few quills disappearing off into the thicket. But Gretchen, yes, I hope we can find some porcupines. I haven't even been seeing too many quills around at the moment, so I wonder where they are all hiding. I was hoping that after that big yawn, or those two big yawns she did, that she was going to get up. Oh, there we go. There we go. I should have said that earlier, everybody. Come on, one more yawn for us. Listen to the male. He's growling. Look how submissive she's acting. Don't let him win you over like that. You show him who's boss. Shame, she's just trying to move around, possibly reposition. And I don't know if you heard that male not being very friendly towards her, and you saw her straight away sit back down in a very submissive position. Oh, she's going, okay, fine, I won't move a muscle. I'll just stay here forever. She looks like quite a young female. I'm not sure if it is the youngest female of the Nkuhumas. I'm still learning each of the different characters of that pride and any key identifying features, but she does look very young. She's got no suckle marks, and I know the only other female that doesn't have any cubs. I think it's amber eyes. So this could possibly, and this is definitely not amber eyes, so I think it is that younger female. And she probably hasn't realized that if she wants to, she can stand up to a big male lion. Obviously, he's much larger than her and probably could do a little bit more damage. And normally when the lionesses get into an argument with a male, they all gang up on that one male. So that's probably why she is also deciding to just retreat. It's because she hasn't got anybody to back her up, and there is another Birmingham male here, and that might happen where they gang up on her and then she'll be in some serious trouble. But I don't know if that's going to happen. I suppose she's actually quite a smart girl. No, they don't even mind Mike leaving the sighting. They are not lifting their heads at all. Right, well, I watch these lions sleep soundly. Jamie's got a footprint of some kind for you.
So we've actually got a really, really nice track here. And after the rain, it's not often that we get a patch of sand that is soft enough for the animal's foot to really dig into. But this is a really beautiful example of a hyena track. Just have a look at this. It's so clearly imprinted in the mud. It's absolutely astounding. Now let's talk a little bit about hyena tracks, because we always sort of dismiss them. We talk about how, oh well, it's just a hyena whenever we've seen a track. And it's really important to be able to distinguish between them. And they also tell you a great deal about the animal itself. So this is its front foot here. And hyenas walk in a very particular way. With leopards and lions, their front left will and their back left will fall in the same line. And then their right front and their back right will fall in a line like this. So they kind of walk in a straight line. With hyenas, they do what's known as a crosswalk. So there's a directional pattern to where their feet fall. So the track, the front track, kind of points outwards in one direction. The back track points in the opposite direction. And that's a really nice, quick way of distinguishing when you see tracks in the road. You can see it from the way that the tracks are angled, that it's a hyena. The back of the pad, standard, two lobes, as opposed to the three of a leopard track. And really nice crescent-shaped outside toes. They look a little bit like kidney beans. That was a terrible demonstration, but they look sort of kidney bean-shaped, and they fit together. Hyena tracks fit together beautifully like puzzle pieces. And then here, claws, which of course you wouldn't see in the track of a leopard or a lion. You would see it in the track of a cheetah. And that's where the back of the lobes and the position of the foot becomes important in determining which way. Now the question I have for you, I was going to tell you, but I'm actually going to make it a quiz because I think that you can see it clearly enough. Which side is each foot? So which is this, the left or the right foot, the front track? And is the back track the left or the right foot? And let's see if you can figure that out. And to make that slightly easier, I'm trying to think if we can make that slightly easier, but I can't, because the rest of the tracks have kind of been washed away. Just a little hint, the tracks or the paws of animals are kind of like our hands. So what I mean by that is this is my right hand, obviously. Let me put it here. This is my right hand. Ignore my thumb, because of course in the paws that's not going to stick out. These are my four toes. And my middle finger is like the middle toe of the animal. It is the longest of the toes. And see if you can't work out which one this is. Now I better memorize, because I'm going to leave and then you're going to send through answers and I'm not going to know if I'm right or wrong. Let me just work this out. Okay. Let's see if you can figure out, is the front foot left or right, and is the back foot left or right? And of course, the hyena's crosswalk, the way that they walk, is a very energy efficient, energy saving gait. It's half the reason why they've got that sloping back. Obviously, I know it's the front foot versus the back foot because of the size. Animals, excepting cheetah, the animals will always have bigger front feet. They're bigger and rounder. A cheetah track, by contrast, let me try this, I'm no artist, because they're very similar in size, is more elongated. So it kind of has a very, they've got very sharp lobes at the back, much sharper than a leopard or a lion, and they're much more elongated. That is a terrible cheetah track. That's not clear at all. Awful. We'll scrap that from the record. My apologies. That didn't work at all. All right. So let's see if you can figure it out. Right. I'm going to very gingerly walk towards the vehicle whilst clutching my microphone. I was going to call it a name, but I'm not going to. My microphone. And attempt to clamber in without losing any sound. Oh, don't sit on the cable. Well played. Hey. Okay. Now I'm going to attempt to reposition with the rain covers. We're very caught up. I think that's shut. Then I'm going to try and find my earpiece. All in all, a bit of a complicated process getting in and out at the moment. Right, I'm going to gently place this, very gently, on my poncho. Oh no. Are we good? Stay. And voila. Okie dokie. And well done to Honey, Ocelot, Renee and Kelvin. And I'm sure many others. Perhaps I made these quizzes too easy. You are absolutely right. The front foot is... Everybody freeze. We're good? We're good. Front foot is left foot and back foot is right foot. Well done. Bravo. Why is that important? Why is it important to distinguish between the left foot and the right foot? I suppose just curiosity, anatomy. Stop it! Okay, I'm going to fiddle with my audio for a little bit and see if I can't find a good position to be in. While I do, let's head across to Taylor.
We've changed angles, as you can see, and also that female got up again and moved to the other side, and she got a scolding from this big Birmingham. Oh, what were you? I heard a noise in the distance, and it also got that female lion's attention, as you can see. I just want to listen very quickly for just a moment. No, I can't hear anything else. But you saw how she's lifted her head up. And she's having a little look around as well. So I'm so glad we heard the same thing. Now, if you look at that branch, and you see how there it is quite red. So it looks like a branch from a bush willow. And at first I thought it was just maybe recently broken off. And it was that bright red color that the bark often shows when it is first broken. But it's actually blood. So I wonder if maybe one of the lions went possibly either chewing on that, or that while they were pulling around this buffalo calf carcass, that pointed was just maybe sticking into it and got covered in a little bit of blood. But you can actually see the carcass now. And they've eaten quite a bit of it. But I think there's still enough meat. They're probably going to be here until tomorrow morning. It depends though, if any more lions join onto this, then they might change their, or they might finish it a little bit earlier. Now, I don't know if this female is itching, is trying to inch her way closer to the carcass so she can start feeding again. She didn't look particularly full. So maybe she's just starving and this poor male won't let her have a bite. Which there is plenty to go around, so I think that's quite mean. It would be nice though if the other Birmingham, the Nkuhums females came through. I can hear something.
in the distance. You saw those lions pop their heads up. I'm hearing exactly what they're hearing. Something. What did I just see? Oh, was it? I thought I saw something moving in the bushes in the distance. But now I'm unsure. I can hear another vehicle coming down the road, but that wasn't what they were looking at. We could hear something behind us. Let's see when this noisy vehicle moves away. Maybe we'll be able to hear a little bit better. Still nothing, still no more development on the sounds that we're listening. Sorry, everybody, I'm going to be a little bit quiet now because everybody's looking around them. Lions are listening to something. I can hear something. No, it's stopped again. Okay. Maybe it wasn't anything too important. Come on, girl, get up and just come on over and have a nibble. Let's see if she's going to inch her way forward. Sorry, everybody, that was me. There was a branch that was creeping in and poking me. Oh, look at the male. Now he's stopped. He's resting his head on the buffalo's head. Oh, he was. No, now he's going to roll over. Here we go. Now it's your opportunity to come a little bit closer. One paw on the kill, just to say this is mine. There we go. She's going to try and sneak again. Watch a female. She keeps trying to inch around, and then the male lets off a growl and looks up, and then she goes back into a very submissive position again. Noises have stopped and our turtle dove has not moved anywhere, still hanging around. Just taking a moment just to appreciate all the sounds that are going on around us. And if you've just tuned into the show, you are looking at one of the Nkuhums Female Alliance. Quite a big pride. They consist of 5 female lions with 8 cubs, but we're unsure where the rest of them are. And then we've also got 2 Birminghams in the sighting with us. We've got our injured male who we're following up, and he is soundly sleeping. And we've got this male over here keeping a close eye on his kill. And we're also listening to a turtle dove. So if you'd like to send me any questions, I'm waiting for some of you to send through any questions that you've got. And you can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you're welcome to email us at questions@wildearth.tv. I can hear the vultures going crazy in the distance. Morning, Ellie. Ellie wants to know if I've got any good lion stories. I have to think about that one. You know, we're so fortunate to see cats all the time. I'm trying to think if I've got any really good ones. Okay, everybody, what I want to do, though, I can hear the vultures going absolutely berserk in the distance. I want to go back to that first kill that we were at earlier. We're watching the vultures just to see what's going on over here. Oh, hang on. What are you doing, Burmy? Oh, hang on. Let's look here. Oh, hello. 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 This is exciting. I should have said. Oh, look, finally. He's said you can join on the kill. That's nice. Did you see how he got up and went over to her? And she responded
by greeting. Oh my goodness, he's right at the vehicle. Look at that. Like, it literally right in my front of my crew Land Rover. Wow, he's close. He's really big as well. You don't really get to see how big these animals are until they come right up to the side of your door. But that was nice. So she got up, she responded, she greeted him. You saw there how they rubbed cheeks. And that was him basically saying, you can come and you can feed on the carcass. And I think that's what she's just been waiting for this entire time. Okay, we'll spend a few more minutes here before we go and check out those vultures. That's quite nice. Maybe he decides to change his mind again. And we see a little bit of a argument. But now he's sleeping. Kashi's munching away there. What a cat-packed morning it has been, everybody. Leopards, not just one leopard, two leopards. Lions chasing leopards up trees. Vultures, a quick glimpse of hyenas. All happening this morning. And she's going to munch on this calf. A vulture just flew over. That's what those lions lifted their head for. It flew over quite low, in fact. Obviously coming in, hoping that the lions will move off. Oh, my goodness, it's flying right here in front of us. It almost came and landed on the vehicle. So that is a hooded vulture that I was telling you about. So now you can quickly just recap on the hierarchies of vultures. You can see how slender that beak is in comparison to the white-backed vulture, which we were looking at earlier. So you can see there, not really good for tearing open thick hides of animals. But it came right over us. Just sitting there. And they will. These vultures are all going to sit in the tree and wait for the lions to move off. Wow. Have a look at this lion again. Good morning, James Richard. James would like to know which is the heaviest of our vulture species. Now, my guess straight off the bat is going to be the leopard faced, but I will have a look quickly in my bird book just to confirm this, but I'm pretty sure it's the leopard faced vulture. Right, I'm on vultures. Let's have a look. Let's do white backed. Get quite big. So white back gets between 4.6 and 6.6 kilograms. Leopard face, wow, yes, a leopard face can weigh up to 8.5 kilograms. That's impressive. So I definitely think that that is the heaviest. I'm just checking the others. Nope, leopard faced is the heaviest of the vultures that we see. And let me just check the white headed. Just want to see in comparison to the white backed. White headed, where are you? Why can't I find you? Here we are. Yes, so even the white headed and the white backed are sort of around the same. Not varying in weight too much. Lots of vultures coming in now though. So I don't know what maybe chased them off that other kill. Like I said earlier, I heard lots of, or just actually a few moments ago, I heard lots of activity from those vultures. But we'll go and have a look. We're just having a quick look at this female lion munch away. Here we go. I don't know if you can hear the sounds of her trying to pull the meat off of all the bones. Can you hear that? Listen. Wow. If Mr. Turtle Dove would stop singing for us though, then we could hear even better. Oh, it's quite nice to hear different things though while we're sitting watching a lioness feed on a carcass. And I think she's finding some good chunks there because she's really just reaching and biting and pulling some meat. I need to try and reposition us just a little bit. I actually just want to edge on forward. because we're quite, this male is laid quite close to us now, so I think he's going to lift his head if I start the vehicle, but I want to go around to get a different view. Let's go to Jamie while I maneuver around so we can get a really good view of this lion eating, but I'll see you shortly.
I'm currently occupied attempting to turn the key to my car. Hey Rusty, old familiar problem, huh? Okay, ooh. This is residue of oil from where we've tried to fix this problem before. Okay, let's try that again. Okay, let's jiggle the steering wheel a little bit. Sometimes that loosens it. Just a gentle creak. Well, isn't this view lovely? I think of all the places in the world to find oneself stuck, this is quite a nice spot, don't you think, Dave? It's good. Enjoy it, because we might be here a while. You know the scene in Fawlty Towers where Basil Fawlty's car breaks down and he loses his tempo? He was rushing around, I think he was rushing around trying to feed some important guests a dinner of duck, and his car breaks down and he loses it, and he gets out and he finds a stick or a branch and he gives the car a jolly good thrashing. I'm about two steps from there, but I'm very fond of Rusty. And I don't want to mistreat her, but at the same time, I would really like to move now. Okay, we're playing a game, are we? Cool. We're playing Let's Find 10 Things Around Me. Okay, we'll start off pretty obvious. We'll start with the gwari bush on my left. The gwari bush, one of the few remaining green trees out here. Very useful as a fire beater and not much else except for the toothbrush, but that's an old guiding cliche. Let's move on to the jackalberry, which is right next to it, a young jackalberry. You can, left. There we go, sorry Dave. I often forget that, of course, our poor cameramen are not trained guides necessarily, and whilst they do know things, I can't get out of the car, Bex. You do realise this because of my mic. Okay, so, jackalberries. Named jackalberry because of the mysterious nature of their growth, like a mysterious jackal, and also because the jackals eat their berries as well. Lots of our jackalberries are fruiting at the moment. It is also known as Diospyros mesiliformis. Oh, the video's gone. Fantastic. I'm having a great time. I would like to... Over to Taylor.
We've repositioned and we have got a beautiful angle, everybody. Look at this. And I was surprised, they didn't even mind me repositioning. The male lifted his head when I started the vehicle, so I sat quietly with the vehicle running for a little bit, and then I maneuvered around and he had his head glued to the ground. Look at this. Isn't this amazing? Just got this little gap here between the trees. You're going to get some phenomenal screenshots now of this lioness feeding. And she's found a nice spot. She's stuck in. Look how she's sticking her head right in there. And I bet she's going to pull out a nice chunk of flesh. I think she's getting to some parts that the boys haven't been able to eat yet. Look how she's using both paws and she's ripping really. They're so strong. How they grasp on like that and they just pull. It's amazing. My earpiece is coming out. Let me fix it. There we go. Now she's using her conochial shear. You see how she chews on this, she sort of pulls her face to one side and then she gnaws away. And those are just two teeth that are scissoring against each other and slicing the meat off. It's called the carnassial shear. I love it when she eats and then she looks towards us. That's beautiful. There we go. Perfect example. Though she's not really having to use the carnassial shear just yet, or as much as that she will, because there's still quite a bit of flesh on this buffalo. You can see her pulling chunks off every now and then. Yum. And I love how her front of her nose and around her whiskers are all nice and red now. That's also, if you can get an opportunity to take a screenshot when she looks over at us or in the distance, that is beautiful. So I'm wondering though, the buffalo, the big buffalo that they killed first, I wonder if that was a female. Oh, I wonder if it was a bull. We didn't really get to see because the head was underneath the body. It was quite big, but I wonder if they got this calf as well. Maybe they separated the two of them from the herd that was moving through here. And they obviously killed two birds with one stone. And it's proven worthy now that they are able to keep feeding for a few days. Nancy wants to know if vultures would risk coming in and trying to feed on a kill while the lions are sleeping around it. Now, Nancy, that will depend on how far away the lions were sleeping to their kill. In this case, no. It would be a very silly vulture if it were to fly down and try and peck on this carcass. The lions would just not allow it. They would chase it away, firstly. And if it's not quick enough, like we were talking about earlier, it could even get caught and get killed, which obviously would not be ideal for the vulture. So, Nancy, it just depends on how far away the lions are. So if these lions get up and move maybe 20 meters away, you might find a vulture will just hop down. And they might start hanging around on the ground, because then they know they have got enough space to get away if the lion does get up and try to chase them. And to see if they can take a little pick. I see quite a bit of the stomach contents out on the ground. I don't know if you can see them here. And possibly if the vultures, here we go, next to that back leg. If the vultures can come through and grab that, and then they might jump off with it. We saw that lovely vulture, sort of, I don't know what you would call that. That movement that they're doing, that sort of hopping, vulture hop. They would grab that and then they would move away and then try and feed on it somewhere in a safe distance. So that's what they would ideally do. Wow, look at that. Now you can even see right inside the buffalo as well. These Nkuhums females are incredible huntresses. So far, since I've been here, every time they've attempted to make a kill, well, we saw them miss the kudu and we saw this young female chasing the giraffe around. However, they are persistent. That day that they go out and they've got it in their head that they're going to catch something, they do catch something. Who we got flying in here? Sounds like we've got some drongos coming in. Oh, now they've gone away. Oh, yum. That was a good piece. There we go. He's got a nice chunk. And she was also very persistent and very patient, and she realized it's a great technique that she did. If she acts submissive, that eventually this male is going to allow her to feed on the carcass. And she is indeed having a lovely feast. I just love it how they don't even care about us being here and sitting next to them, watching them feed. To me, that is truly amazing, seeing the biggest predator in Africa a mere 10 meters away from me, maybe even less. Oh, now she's going to try and turn the calf over. So she might as well, every now and then, like we just saw, try and reposition the carcass just so that she can feed on all those fleshy bits that have been missed by the Birmingham boys. She better be careful not to pull it around too much, because I fear that this Birmingham laying close to her will not be impressed by that and may start to show some hostility towards her.
Good morning, David. So David wants to know if lions will eat vultures. So David, we were chatting about this probably about 40 minutes ago. We had a question come through, pretty much the same thing. Now, I've never seen it in person. However, I have seen a documentary where a young male lion caught a vulture at a watering hole and then proceeded to eat it. So that's the only time I've ever seen it happen. And I don't think a starving lion would pass up the opportunity to eat something like that. I mean, if you're out in the bush and you eat meat and the only thing you were able to catch was a vulture by a miracle, then I'm sure you're going to eat it. I don't think you're going to say no. Remember, the animals don't read the same books as us. So we can say one thing about animals and they can turn around and do something completely different. Really got lots of red on her face now. Good morning, Ellen Fowler. Ellen wants to know if we know where the Nkuhumas are since the big rain. No, we don't, unfortunately. Well, however, we have a suspicion that they are nearby. I don't think they are too far away from the last buffalo kill and where we are now. I think they're in this sort of triangle. Hopefully they'll come out this afternoon. And when we found the lions on the bigger buffalo kill yesterday morning, we didn't have a great view and I could only see the three older cubs. And remember, Jamie found one of the other females that was lactating, which I presume was the mother of the youngest cubs. Possibly she stashed them somewhere and that's when Jamie caught her in the act, was coming back after feeding those little cubs, which is unusual because they're old enough to come out onto the kills. And we have seen them in a sighting before with the little ones and a kill. So I'm not sure what happened there, maybe because all the Birminghams are back. I don't know if those little cubs have been surrounded by so many Birminghams before. I'm not 100% certain, but I think in the next day or two we're going to find those little cubs and see how they're doing. But we know that all the females have had a good feed, so we know that then those little ones have had a good feed. Mom will be producing lots and lots of milk. It has been miserable as well, Ellen. We've had so much wind over the past few days. I'd also want to hide away in a drainage line somewhere. Look at that. Oh, wow. Now you can see she's quite a young lioness by looking at her teeth. See how lovely and sharp they are. They're still quite clean. They haven't sort of got any calcification on them, or that sort of builds up all that plaque. You can't see that. They're nice and clean still and nice and sharp. As the lions get older, their teeth tend to wear down quite a bit. That's also another way you can age them. You see their lovely teeth. Because she's, oh wow. You can actually see how she's trying to do the carnassial shear. So she's not using her canines. She is using her incisors just behind that. You can see there. So the canines are really only there for sort of closing the jugular or trying to sever the spine of an animal. They're not used for feeding. One munch on that piece again. Another vulture flying over. That's what got her attention. You're all coming in now.
having a little look around her. What have you seen? Nothing. Nothing that holds her attention for too long. Just being cautious. Though I would feel fairly safe with two big, strong Birmingham boys laying next to me.
So we've been chatting quite a bit about the next week and how we're going to be doing long game drives, sort of 7-hour game drives with conjunction with James being in the Mara. Now, James Richard wants to know, what is my personal longest game drive that I've ever done? I'm trying to remember. I think it'd have to be one in Zambia, where we went out from about 8 o'clock in the morning and we got back at about 7 in the evening, between 6:30 and 7 o'clock in the evening. And that was a long day. Amazing, but really, really hot, and we saw some incredible things. So that's probably the longest, but I quite enjoy doing day drives. Often what I would do with my guests is, especially if they were staying for quite a few days, I think the best amount of time to come and stay on the reserves. If you can stay 4 days, amazing. Otherwise, two nights is too short. So if you can do 3 or 4 nights, that's incredible. But I know some of these lodges can be quite expensive, unfortunately. But it's really, really worth it. And what I would do is, obviously, we do the normal routine, afternoon safari, early morning safari, and afternoon safari. And the next day, I would suggest to them that, why don't we sleep in, let everybody have a little rest, and then let's go out after breakfast and only come back just before dinner. And I absolutely loved to do those drives. Firstly, because I would be the only person driving on the reserve during those hours. Everybody else is back at the lodge or walking and doing all sorts of things. And like I said, I had some of my best sightings in the bush during or in between game drive hours. I'm still trying to think of my favorite lion sighting that I've had. I've had some pretty incredible ones, obviously, of lions catching things. I'm trying to think my most memorable lion sighting. I quite enjoy it when the elephants chase the lions. I've had a few of those before. That's quite funny to watch how they all get up and scatter when the elephants come charging through. I think I'm going to tell this story. So one morning I was left the lodge, and let you know that I'm still actually here. So one morning I left the lodge, and I picked up some lion tracks. It was of the Southern Pride and the two Charleston males and their two little cubs that they have. And so I'm just checking everything. So picked up their tracks, and I knew that there was a dam called, there were two dams quite close by, and I wasn't sure which one to go to. So I said to my tracker, I said, Kenny, what do you think? And he says, no, he thinks we should go this way. And I said, okay, I agree with him. We drove on along, and as we came around the corner of this watering hole, then we found the entire pride lions, but they were fast asleep. So you know me now, I was a bit disappointed. I thought we were going to catch them. It was very early in the morning. I thought we were going to catch them still moving around. Anyway, so we sat with them. I explained to my guests how important it is to be patient when you are out in the bush. And we did so. So we sat for about an hour and a half. The next minute, we heard the mooing of a herd of buffalo coming through. And everybody poked their ears and eyes up, and they were looking in the distance. And they were sitting sort of behind a depression. And I thought, fantastic, this is going to be amazing. So we sat and we sat and we sat, and this herd of buffalo, it was a hot day, comes through, not even any idea that the lions were there. And they came into the water, drinking, all completely submerged, have some of them having a roll around, and the lions slowly crept up onto the dam wall, and they all flanked and went either side. And then one of the young lionesses, as we've seen, very keen huntress, she got up and she raced down, and she actually went into the water and she grabbed a young buffalo calf. Actually, let's have a look. Very much the same size as this calf that you're looking at over here. And she grabbed it and then dragged it out of the water. And once she got to the top of the water, she had this buffalo by the throat. And we were all, yeah, cheering, going, woo, you know, live buffalo, amazing, so incredible. And then the herd of buffalo, there were about 50 of them, turned around and said, no, right, we're coming back for you, and stormed straight towards her.
Now, a wall of buffalo is quite intimidating. And now the other lionesses were obviously making their way around to try and help kill this buffalo. I couldn't believe the strength, though, how this one female lion just had this buffalo calf by the throat and was just throwing it around like it was a piece of paper. And the buffalo came charging on in, and the female eventually dropped the buffalo calf and she ran away. She actually didn't want to lose her life over the buffalo calf. The buffalo calf laid there for a moment, stood up, shook its head, and then it ran off into the middle of the herd. And most of the herd moved off. There was a group of females, older females, as well as some big bulls that stood behind and watched carefully. And then they actually chased the entire pride away. The tables turned completely. There was an almost buffalo hunt. So that was actually quite exciting, just because of the dynamics. And the two little cubs, who were obviously, they were just resting, were just sitting on the dam wall watching the entire thing. So I think it was a very important learning experience for those young cubs as well. So that must be one of my favorite lion sightings I have. And I hope you enjoyed that little tale. Here we go, let's see. Now she's probably going to pick this buffalo up now. Grab it, yes. Find a nice spot and pull it towards you. She's found something else. And she's licking a little bit of the blood on the inside there. She's just changed position. Charles from Florida wants to know why lions have the black markings on the back of their ears. Now, Charles, most animals have some form of a follow me sign. And in this case, on the lions, they have got the black markings on the back of their ears. And maybe let's have a look at this male's tip of his tail, just so I can show Charles.